Some people try dating apps. Others beg their friends to set them up with someone. And these people are willing to display their private lives and past traumas in order to find love. They are the brave ones, isn't it? Welcome back, babies. It's Paula, and today we're unraveling the ins and outs on how the reality show Love is Blind is a great example of evolutionary psychology, which I never thought I would say that. So grab a coffee. Or I don't have a coffee. I've already drank like 2 coffees today, so I just limited myself, and now I'm drinking some like herbal tea with no caffeine. Anyway, because much energy is required to keep up with the drama. And in case you didn't know, yes, I got myself a new microphone. I'm super excited. It's so cool. And well, let's unravel the reason why you find your girlfriend's taste in men disgusting. Guys, I never watch Netflix, but there's this only exception called Love is Blind that comes out twice a year. It is honestly a mind-blowing show, not only because of its entertaining purposes, because it's highly entertaining and hooking, but also because it's a rich source of analysis. Many, many people on the internet are like tuning in and reviewing the show, which is really funny. And while I was soaking up all the drama, question pounded my head. Is love truly blind? The show is a huge success, and to be fair, it's not because of a magical production or a hilarious cast, but rather for the strategic structure of the show. In case you've been living under a rock, or you have a high social life, it just depends on how you look at it, and you don't know what Love is Blind is, let me tell you real quick. It's a dating show where a bunch of people date each other, like 20 men and 20 women, well, 30 men and 30 women, date each other for a week. And throughout those 7 days, the couples must get engaged. But there's like a little nuance that makes everything a bit more special. They're like speed dating on pods where they cannot see each other, and it's just so confusing. And if the couples get engaged, they will go on a fake honeymoon with the other couples, and after they will live together for around 2 to 3 weeks. I don't know if it's 2 or 3. And then they have to get married. Well, I mean, they have the choice to do or not, but they are supposedly getting married after 3 weeks. I don't know if it's the best way to find love lasting long, but it's certainly one of the quickest ways to find love. And guys, if to you it seems like a hot, suffocating mess, it's because it is. Which leaves a whole lot of room for people like me to discuss their dream-like reality. And by dream, I'm also including nightmares. So I've been an avid watcher of the show for like, since it first aired in like 2018. And while watching the show, most of my doubts lean more towards like the neuroscience behind the seemingly random success of the marriages. Not only from this season, like the 8th season that's airing right now. Please don't spoil me the show, but feel free to just give your opinion and your predictions on the couples, because this season, the 8th season, is just so wild. After season 7, I was like, okay, that was wild. No season will ever be as wild as this one, but then you get to like the next season and you're like, okay, that's even worse. The drama just keeps being better each and every time. So yeah, what do you think? What do you think that guy's a creep or not? There's a guy who's really creepy and you didn't know it till the last moment. He's like a Joe Goldberg type of man. Oh my god, I need to know what happened. Because in the reveal, it was clear to me like 100% was something wrong from her end. But I just thought that she wasn't attracted to the men. But it turned out that it was something even worse. So yeah, let's just get back to the topic. And when I asked like, which are the traits that make a couple successful in Love is Blind, I took into account like every single season and for how long they have been like the couples married, and I just really wanted to know. So yeah, because at the end of the day, the show is deemed as a social experiment. Like Vanessa and Nick can't stop saying that this is a social experiment, which, to be fair, and while I don't think that the contestants' behavior are being constantly analyzed by scheming scientists in order to extract data regarding their human behavior and how love can be blind, I, of course, believe that the producers use some sneaky techniques to promote conflict between the contestants. In the lounges, the places where, like, women reside and men also reside in between dates, there's a lot of, like, scarcity and secrecy. It's really interesting to see how most of the guys don't even say the names of the girls they are dating, while the girls, yeah, they talk more about it. They talk more about names on, like, this person treated me like this, he said that, he said the other, and the men were like, no, that's that. Yeah, number one is fine. Number two is, like, talking to two guys. Have no idea who they are. And they, like, the guys were all clueless. So yeah, it's really interesting to see, like, the differences of behavior. It is really easy to read between the lines and understand how the questions the producers asked the contestants, especially when they are, you know, talking in private, are to stir up the drama and to, you know, push them to say things that producers want them to say to reinforce a point that it may or may not be true. So yeah, we have to take everything with a grain of salt in those dating shows because it's everything highly edited. But hey, regardless of that, the show is a huge success, which means that the producers are actually doing something right, even if it's ethical or not. Going back to our topic, which are the traits that make a couple, you know, be successful? How the contestants are able to form really deep and good connections in order to have, you know, a lifelong marriage. Because in some instances, it does really feel like the contestants are, you know, being sold a very shiny get love quick scheme. Yes, I took that reference from Taylor Swift. So, which is the actual truth? Well, if we binge watch the show from season 1 to 8, we can get some good stats and insights on the actual rates of the marriages. Out of 210 participants across the first 7 seasons, because the 8th one hasn't finished, so we cannot extract data, and I sadly cannot predict the future anyway. Out of the 210 participants, only 68 got engaged. So they passed, like, the first phase, which is about a third, okay? And then if we take a look at the marriages across the 7 seasons, we can see that 22 couples got married and 11 couples remain still together. I don't know, maybe someone just got divorced and I have no idea, but as the today, the end of February 2025, there are 11 couples still. So it's half of the couples. Half of the couples that get married are still together, which is funny because it means that the divorce rate is a 50%, which is the same as in normal life. So it can mean that the success rate of blind dating marriages is the same as the one of meeting your future life partner while browsing through a bookstore and all of a sudden you two grab the same book at the same time and you just look at each other and start a never-ending conversation. Vanessa and Nick can stop talking about how good the show is. And just so you can be aware of that, guys, if someone tries to convince you by repeatedly telling you how good something is, chances are they are lying. But what are the chances? Well, if we get a bit mathy and we do some compounded probability, we obtain that the chance of getting engaged is 1/3, as I've said. Okay, so if we multiply it by the chance of actually getting married, which is another 1/3, and we also multiply it by the chance of having a long-lasting marriage, so not getting divorced, which is 1/2, if you multiply everything, we get a success rate of 1 out of 18, which is a probability of 0.05, which translates to 5.5% of success. In other words, if you get to participate in Love is Blind, you have a 5% chance of actually getting married and finding the love of your life, which is pretty low because I took some, you know, liberties and started looking on the internet. Most people can say that, like, dating apps are terrible and that people cannot find anything serious in there. The truth is that the rates of successful marriages in dating apps is from 12 to 25%. And the success rate of Love is Blind is 5%. So yeah, it's a scam. Guys, it's a freaking scam. Let's be honest. Like, why is there such a big difference between dating apps and a dating show? Well, since the contestants are pressured into marrying someone they've known for less than a month, and they live in a false reality, the pressure's likely gonna drive them insane, and with the haze judgment, participants are likelier to just adopt less sensible behaviors, which makes good TV. Really good TV. And this makes me wonder if the fast-paced nature of the show is actually hindering the development of healthy, long-lasting relationships. So it's a bit of, you know, a paradox. On one hand, they want people to have long-lasting relationships and good, healthy, long-lasting relationships, but you cannot have that in a fast-paced, highly pressured environment. How can we forget the fact that in the experiment, you cannot see your partner? And studies show that physical attraction actually plays a big role in healthy, long-lasting relationships. In case you want to know why is that, that's because of something called the halo effect, which is a cognitive bias that basically says that if you find someone attractive, you're likely gonna associate that person with other good traits, like being nice, kind, and all of that stuff. For instance, if you find your partner very physically attractive, and they, I don't know, commit a mistake. For instance, they don't make their bed every day, and that's something really big for you. You're gonna be like, oh, he or she just, like, they might just, like, have forgotten about it. It's not a big deal. But if you find your partner not as attractive or rather ugly, and they, you know, never make their bed, and for you it's a big thing, you're gonna be like, like, it's disgusting. Like, you're super responsible. It's just a predisposition our brains have. But another question popped in my head. This led me to a rabbit hole of, like, what makes someone attractive for us? Because everyone has different taste in people. Of course, we can all agree that some people tend to be more attractive than others, and there are some traits that are universally, like, more beautiful. But taste is really, you know, beauty's in the eye of the beholder, 100%. So, which are the objective things that make our brain go, I really like this person, or I find this person disgusting? And I'm gonna tell you guys. The first one being the major histocompatibility complex, or the MHC. From now on, I will just limit myself to say MHC. And the familiar traits we find attractive. By that, I don't mean that you wanna, you know, go to bed with your mom or your dad, okay? What I mean is that our primal brains are wired to detect familiar verbal, nonverbal, and physical traits. And why is it? Well, it's just a safety mechanism, because if someone, like many, many, many centuries and millennials ago, if someone had familiar traits, it was likely because they were of the same tribe as us. So we were much likely to be safe with someone of our tribe. That's why our brain is just predisposed to literally scan the room and find similar patterns that make us feel safe. Also, there's a lot of, like, cultural and societal constructs that play with it. And on the other hand, the MHC is a set of genes that we have in our DNA, and it is responsible for our immune system. We are constantly looking for people with different immune systems than us. And that is really interesting, because it's like, how the hell can you detect someone's DNA? Because you don't go around, you know, like, giving blood tests and DNA tests to people. Well, there's something called endorphins, and those are, like, you know when you're, like, really attracted to someone's sweat or someone's smell? Like, just remember, like, your partner or, like, your ex or someone, like, you had a crush on. You just smelled at them and you were like, yep. That's because their endorphins signal that you two are immunely compatible. That's really, like, nerdy, but That's the neuroscience and biology behind it. Our brains are not wired to attract 6'5", blue eyes, finance guys, but rather people whose immune system are completely different to us. And there's a reason behind it, and the reason being joining forces. The offspring would have both immunities, so he or she would be much stronger. So yeah, next time you think, why am I attracted to this person? It's not them, it's their genes. That's why some of the engagements turn out to be really messy to maintain, and some reveals are just like more awkward than what they should be, because let's be honest, the reveals are extremely awkward. Like sometimes I just want to like pass them because they are poof, they are really awkward. Also, like on the other hand, I love the reveals because it's just the most awkward situation in the world, and you can see their exact reaction and it's hilarious, but because you can just predict, like, this person doesn't like this person, or they like each other, they don't, and it's just so dramatic. Because being with someone who you are not truly attracted to physically will only make you resent your partner, even if you have a highly emotional bond. It's the halo effect. It's the predisposition your brain has if you're not attracted to your partner physically. Every little mistake they do is likely gonna be severely judged by you because of your predisposition towards them. Of course, the opposite is also not so good. Because whenever we undermine people's mistakes and disrespect just because of the way they look, you are condemning yourself to reinforce the disrespect, and you're not gonna end in a really good place. So yeah, we just really need to be more objective and be aware of these biases that affect the way we see people if we want to engage in healthy relationships, which I think we all want. Who wants to live toxically for the rest of their lives? That would make really good TV, but that would be awful for our mental health. And that brings me to the last point, which is like some tips on how you can know if you're attracted to someone or you're just infatuated. We've all been infatuated by someone we've looked at them and we're like, that's the most drop-dead gorgeous person I've ever seen in my life. I'm literally marrying that person. And then they open their mouth and you realize that they cannot put two and two together. What makes a successful marriage successful? Well, I would say it's a mix of everything. You need to be attracted to the person. The marriages that have been successful, in Love is Blind, I'm gonna put some pictures, they are highly attracted to each other, or at least, maybe not in the beginning, but they've learned to build that physical attraction. Studies show that you can actually build physical attraction to people. To a certain extent, of course, if you're highly unattracted by your partner, the marriage is gonna be a disaster, and Love is Blind also has shown us how disastrous marriages can be. So, yeah, the next time you're wondering if you really like this person or if you're only just infatuated, bear in mind this thing. It is one thing to accept their flaws, but it is a whole other thing to accept their disrespect. Would you want your bestie to go through that? Or do you find yourself dismissing their mistakes? Another really important thing, how much do you really know about that person? Because it's so easy for us to just start fantasizing and be like, oh my god, this person's amazing, and you don't even know their last name. So yeah, just keep in mind, there has to be a balance between physical and emotional attraction. And what goes up fast goes down fast. And Love is Blind is a clear example on how you only get a 5% chance of being in love if you literally get together after a week. I'm just gonna end this video saying slow burn romances are the best. So yeah. On that note, have a nice week, I think. I don't know why I keep saying week if I post twice a week. So yeah, I post every Thursday and every Saturday. And yeah, I hope you have a nice week. Why am I repeating myself? Anyway, mwah, have a nice day.